Well, good morning and good evening from wherever you might be joining us here at the India-China Institute at the New School. I'm Mark Frazier, co-director of the India-China Institute, and I'm really excited to see two excellent books coming out last year on urban China and India. And I think you'll soon share in my excitement after learning about these books today and meeting the authors. And we decided to, rather than doing two separate book talks, to set this up as a panel, in order to put the books and the authors in conversation with each other under the heading of New Urbanisms of China and India, perhaps, as we might learn through conversation, not so old urbanisms in some cases. First, we'll hear from Lisa Bjorkman. She's a Humboldt Senior Research Fellow at the Max Planck Institute for Social Anthropology and also a professor of urban affairs at the University of Louisville. She's the author of the prize-winning book, Pipe Politics, Contested Waters, Embedded Infrastructures of Millennial Mumbai, published by Duke University Press in 2015, and also the author of a second book called Waiting Town, Life in Transit and Mumbai's Other World-Class Histories, published in 2020 with Columbia University Press. This is an ethnographic account of knowledge production and the politics of truth-making. She has a current research project on crowd politics and the theatrical idiom of political speech in contemporary India. And the book that she'll be talking about today is a fascinating collection of chapters in which scholars and practitioners have written 36 profiles of people, of individuals that they've encountered throughout their research and practice in Mumbai. And finally, I'm very proud to say that Lisa is a PhD graduate of the New School for Social Research here and in the politics department. And she was the recipient of, in 2006, one of the India-China Institute's Star Travel Grant Awards that got her over to India to begin her research. Next, we'll hear from Nick Smith. Nick is an assistant professor of architecture and urban studies at Barnard College, Columbia. And prior to joining Barnard, he was on the faculty at the Yale National University of Singapore College. Over the past decade, Nick has been working on the very kind of overlooked area, I would say, of peri-urban China, that is the rural urban periphery, where he has conducted wide-ranging research on the development and planning, and indeed, as he'll talk about, the urbanization of village communities. The book he'll be talking about is titled The End of the Village, Planning the Urbanization of Rural China, which investigates the near total urbanization of China's territory and population. And it's based on field work that he's conducted in the city and the territory, we might say, of Chongqing, which, as I'm sure he'll point out, is no ordinary city. It was carved out of Sichuan province over 20 years ago as one of four or five provincial level cities in China, and now has this massive rural and largely mountainous territory and population exceeding over 30 million people. Some of you remember about a decade ago when the Bo Xilai scandal broke out, he had been the leader of that city, but there's much more fascinating developments in Chongqing besides simply the political leadership, and Nick will be talking about that. He received his PhD in urban planning from Harvard and has held visiting positions at Oxford, at Renmin University in Beijing, and at Chongqing University. So after the two presentations, we'll then hear from Amita Bide, whom we're honored and delighted to have joining us today as the discussant for the program. She's now the Dean of the School of Habitat Studies at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, and her recent work has been on issues of urban transformation and their link to inclusive development. She has extensively researched urban local governance and planning, water and sanitation, housing, and land issues. She is on the ICI's External Advisory Board and was a fellowship recipient in ICI's fellowship cohort back in when ICI first started in 2005. And indeed that project was focused on urbanization in China and India. And it's urbanization has been a long-standing area of focus at the India-China Institute, as many of you know. Finally, I'll point out that Amita contributed one of the chapters in the book Lisa will be Lisa will be talking about Bombay Brokers, a fascinating profile of a data entrepreneur and resident of an informal settlement, not very far from where the Tata Institute is located. She'll offer comments and questions following Lisa and Nick's presentations. And along the way, to the audience, please feel free to add your questions to the Q&A, and we will certainly get to those later in the program. So with all that said, and with your patience, I'm grateful for your patience, we'll now turn it over to Lisa, who's joining us from Naples today. Lisa, welcome.
Thanks so much, Mark. I'm going to share my screen. Okay, this should work. Can everybody see this first screen? Yeah, great. Yes, thank you so much for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be here and to have this opportunity to speak with all of you about this book, Bombay Brokers, which, as Mark mentioned, is a collaboration among 36 ethnographers, and it was published last year with Duke University Press. You can see the Duke cover on the left, and it's also being published just this month with Yoda Press in Delhi. You can see the Yoda cover on the right. I'm particularly excited to be presenting in this space today, where we're having a sort of discussion about comparison, because it's as I'll talk about a little bit later in my presentation, it's something I've been thinking about a lot these days. What kind of comparative insights might this book yield for thinking about sort of global urban transformations or the sort of global present more generally? So anyway, since the book and its arguments are animated by ethnography, I think the best way to begin is with a story. So I'm going to jump right in with a story. In 2014, I moved into a lovely and crumbling old tenement building in the central Mumbai neighborhood of Dadar. The tiny one-room flat had belonged to my friend Kranti's granny, who had recently passed away after having lived in the flat for more than 60 years. Granny's own daughters had long ago moved out of their childhood home in the so-called Dadar Chawl and into the larger and more comfortable residences in New Bombay and Goa and in Heidelberg. The little room remained shuttered while the building awaited for the promised redevelopment under some or another government scheme. And it was in this context that Kranti's suggestion that, hey, you could stay in Granny's flat, suggested to me a fine solution to the perennial problem of where to stay in Mumbai, this time for a 6-month visit. Now, getting the place in shape was easy enough. We just called in a carpenter to replaster the ceiling and slap a fresh coat of paint on the walls. The room was already outfitted with a bed and a desk, and the kitchen was fully outfitted with pots and pans. You can see the kitchen on the left. The only catch was the cooking gas. See, the problem was that Granny's propane cylinder delivery subscription had been canceled after she passed away. When Kranti called up the propane company to inquire about getting the subscription restarted, she was told that a new subscription would require current residents' proof of address documents. Documents which, of course, since nobody actually lived there anymore, did not exist. Without proof of residence documents, it was simply not possible to get a gas subscription or connection, as these subscriptions are so aptly called in Mumbai. And buy the cylinder direct purchases for domestic purposes were simply not available through any of the city's retail or propane suppliers. So I called Rashid. Rashid was, among other things, the proprietor of two small but bustling roadside tea shops. This is not Rashid's tea shop, but one that looks a bit like it. Neither of Rashid's tea shops happened to have a commercial license. So I figured that perhaps Rashid might be able to connect me with any other buy the cylinder retail options. Meanwhile, Kranti beseeched me, half joking, to please keep a low profile and not to scandalize Granny's longtime neighbors with the comings and goings of rough and tumble broker types. Rashid arrived a few hours later. This is not Rashid, but this is somebody who is also moving propane cylinders. He arrived a few hours later, huffing a propane cylinder up the stairs to Granny's third floor flat with the help of a young man I hadn't met before. I paid Rashid in cash for the propane, a small deposit for the cylinder, plus the price of the gas, and not a single rupee more. I asked Rashid, well, didn't you have to pay something extra? He shook his head, waving his hand dismissively. No, no, nothing like that. I was puzzled. But it's not allowed. Rashid explained, see, they don't give these cylinders to just anyone, but they'll give it to me. He says this with no little pride. I pressed him without probing the identity of Rashid's they, but how can they be sure they won't get into trouble? Rashid explained, I'm a businessman. I buy propane from them every day. He tells me that the men at the warehouse know this, and so they are confident that Rashid must have managed things properly. Why would I take any risk, he asks me, when my own business depends on it? Well, this seemed to me a good point. Rashid's knowledge of where such risk might lie, as well as his understanding of how to manage those risks, is born of his deep familiarity and his knowledge of Mumbai, an unquantifiable expertise born of a life spent navigating and connecting, as he puts it, the highly complex, constantly changing, and often contradictory socio-political, institutional, and material fabric of the city. To survive and thrive in Mumbai, Rashid has learned to divine the dangers, the financial, social, material, and ethical dangers that are posed by so many unknowns and contradictions, and to reconcile the risks they pose with the requirements, the possibilities, and the pleasures of everyday life. It was Rashid's mastery in these matters of divination and reconciliation, of course, that inspired me to ring him up that April morning and ask his help in resolving my gas cylinder conundrum. Bombay Brokers, this book, is about people like Rashid, people whose material and practical expertise make possible the everyday functioning of a city like Mumbai, which is one of the world's larger and more dynamic cities. But these are all people whose work is, and somewhat paradoxically, is frequently the subject of much moralizing hand-wringing. So much talk about so-called corruption or state incapacity or market failure and so on. So the book takes this paradox, the morally fraught and yet indispensable character of certain kinds of labor and knowledge, as a jumping off point for exploring broader questions about economic and technological and social and political transformations, not only in Mumbai, but at the global level as well. So the ethnographic heart of the book is comprised of 36 character profiles, each of which is written by one of the book's contributing authors. And you can see the table of contents here. And the 36 profiles are grouped into six themes according to the sort of domains of mediation, or, you know, what the broker is brokering. And these are, you know, the ideas of development of property, business, difference, publics, and truth. And all of these are in scare quotes. Each profile explores the ethnographic content as well as the historical specificity of the activities that come to be described in Mumbai in these kinds of neither here nor there terms like brokerage. So what does this work actually entail, right? They wake up and what do they do? What are the stakes of these activities and for whom? What is required? What kinds of resources are required for some crucial work to be done? What do you need to know? What kinds of, you know, materials does one need in order to accomplish this work? What renders these particular areas of expertise so valuable and so necessary now in this particular historical moment and in this particular city? Indeed, so valuable that sometimes this labor can command its own price, and quite often it does command its own price. So Bombay Brokers takes the city of Bombay and the paradoxical centrality and liminality of these practices as ethnographic sites and methodological points of entry for probing broader level transformations. Wait, is that my thing being funny? You can hear me? Can everybody hear me? Is it good? Okay. And for thinking about the transformations that are characterizing the global present. So the book demonstrates how embodied expertise enacted at particular moments and in particular locations mediates the material and practical contradictions that characterize the global present. So this isn't just a book about Bombay. It's about sort of looking through or from Bombay in order to shine new light into sort of broader global transformations at different scales. So the people who are profiled, they demonstrate virtuosity in managing or mitigating these various kinds of contradictions. And this sheds light on the material skills and resources that they enlist in doing this. So using ethnography to probe these frictions and contradictions is a methodological strategy for generating new insights into the current historical juncture, which is to say, and in light of our conversation today, which is comparative, one comparative insight that Bombay Brokers yields is in fact methodological. The book demonstrates the value in attending ethnographically rather than say normatively or just conceptually to the practical expertise upon which contemporary life depends. And accounting for the salience in Mumbai of the material, the particularly material dimensions of these sort of liminal yet indispensable practices brings into view some of the significant shifts governing the built form of the city and transforming the lives of urban inhabitants. So things like, you know, the introduction of market ideas and devices into the city's development planning frameworks, for example, or the explosion of mobile communication technologies and new media platforms, and of course, the new social imaginaries that these set in motion. So the comparative question here is not how and whether similar shifts are or aren't happening in other, you know, comparative or comparable cities, however we might think about comparability. Nor is the comparative question about measuring Mumbai's particularities against some kinds of ideal typical arrangements or normative ideals in sort of, you know, privileged ideals or concepts in urban planning or urban studies or anthropology. So ideals about, say, you know, the modern state or political mediation or urban economies or entrepreneurialism. Or the kind of broader socio-spatial transformations that are sometimes said to characterize the global present more generally. Rather, the ethnographic material in the book raises comparative questions concerning how embodied expertise enacted in particular locations mediate the material and practical and institutional contradictions and frictions that are taking place at different scales, global, national, regional, virtual. So it's the contradictions and incongruities and conflicts that are born of these multi-scalar transformations that the work of the profiled people mediates. So the comparative question might be something like, what new and emerging forms of labor and knowledge are simultaneously indispensable and yet morally suspect in everyday city life? What sorts of socio-material and institutional conflicts or gaps come into focus when we shift our empirical and analytical attention to the everyday labor of bridging these gaps? What are brokers brokering? What are fixers fixing? And it's these sorts of comparative questions about the material practical content of activities glossed as brokerage, right? And these are phenomena that might otherwise be glossed as sort of idiosyncrasies of particular cities and their histories. It's from this kind of focus on brokerage that we find new understandings and insights about the contemporary historical moment. So shifting our focus away from the figure of the broker or ideas or concepts of brokerage as such, right, whether brokerage or brokers are to be celebrated or condemned. And of course, this is the question with which so much contemporary popular and scholarly writing is concerned, right? The way that, you know, broker good, broker bad. Rather, we're asking broker what? This allows us to attend to the more interesting question of, you know, how and why these activities are so indispensable. So, oh, and I'll just say really quickly that, you know, I'm here in Naples at the moment, as I mentioned, and one of the projects I'm working on is actually to ask this Bombay question of the Italian city of Napoli. So we have 25 ethnographers for a project called Napoli Navigators, and we're trying to think this similar question. So if we think about, you know, what are places, cities in the world that seem to be full of this kind of necessary labor that doesn't have a proper institutionalized job description. And it seems that there are some cities in the world that seem to be overrun by this kind of labor, which doesn't quite have a proper job description. And Napoli is one of them. And what we're learning, if you look at the table of contents here, you know, we have these sort of six domains of mediation, what the brokers, the domains of mediation that are coming up in Napoli are quite different. So it's a very generative, asking a Bombay question of Napoli is a very generative thing. So in what time I have remaining, I just want to present one of the book's characters, which comes from the last chapter, which is about people who deal in truths. So the people who are profiled in the truth chapter make it their business, often quite literally make it their business, to sort through and to adjudicate a cacophony of rivaling and irreconcilable truth claims and to mediate the contradictions that they encounter in their efforts. And I'll add that it is a particular honor to be presenting a profile from the truth chapter today because Professor Bida, who will be commenting today, also has written a brilliant profile, which appears in this chapter. So I'm going to talk for a moment about Atre Sen's chapter. A prison surrogate named Pawan, who makes a living serving jail time in the name of politically connected and better off Mumbaikers who have been convicted of some or another crime, but who are able and willing to pay in cash to escape going to prison. Pawan's profile explores the various audiences for multiple versions of truth. And it reveals how Pawan's expertise as a so-called prison master makes it possible for multiple and conflicting truths to coexist. So Pawan was born and brought up in rural Maharashtra, and it was his love of Bollywood music that brought him to Bombay as a young man. And here I'm just going to read a short excerpt from the profile. Once in the big city, Pawan realized that finding work was not easy. His first experience being locked up in a neighborhood police station came after he had tried to steal a radio from a local shop. In the police station, Pawan entertained everyone with his songs and his dancing. He was so good at gyrating to Bollywood music that the police constable eventually passed him a long strip of cloth through the prison bars. Pawan wrapped the cloth around his waist and danced like Madhuri Dixit and did some exciting twirling, which made both the prisoners and the policemen applaud with laughter. 2 days later, Pawan was released for being a fun chap. And while saluting goodbye to the inhabitants of this small police prison world, he realized it was also his first experience of fun in Mumbai. Pawan was arrested again several times, sometimes for things like aggravated assault, and sometimes for intoxicated misdemeanors in public places. In every prison that Pawan encountered, music went with him. He would sing and crack jokes and keep the prisoners and his cellmates and the jailer and the wardens all entertained. It wasn't perfect, mind you, he said. He didn't like the fact that he had to sleep on urine after prisoners pissed on the floor when the wardens refused to let them out at night. And he did catch some deadly infections and his body was covered with insect bites and pieces of shit would pop up in the milk because the wardens stole the pure milk and topped up the cans with water from the toilet. But Pawan learned over time to churn the milk to see if the shit floated to the top. And if it remained at the bottom of the cans, the milk would be infected for long enough to lead to an outbreak of diarrhea. If it floated to the top, Pawan and the other prisoners would scoop it out to limit the spread of the disease. Through music, dances, mimicry, and jokes, and keeping the wardens in good humor, Pawan managed to gain enough knowledge about the moods and the maps of prison management to keep both the prisoners and the wardens in his pocket. One morning, out of prison, as Pawan lay in his shanty smoking a joint, one of his mates told him that the local party leader, a man named Anant, had asked Pawan to visit him in the party office. Now, Pawan was confused at first. He was unaware of local party politics, but he was aware of local party politics, but he didn't understand most of it. When Pawan entered Anant's office, Anant looked up at his visitor and he said, "Welcome, welcome, prison master." The party leader asked whether Pawan would be willing to be a prison surrogate. So that's the end of the quote. We see in the profile of Pawan's work as a prison master, that it isn't clear, that it's clear that being a surrogate does not always sit well with him. Pawan expresses resentment toward the rich kids who get to rape and murder, but then dodge prison. And yet we see as well how the compulsions of poverty compel Pawan to bracket his moral commitments to equality before the law, and to use his own body in mediating the contradictions of an extremely unequal city and society. Pawan's expertise in surviving prison enables him to metabolize these societal contradictions. On the one hand, he takes pride in the status and virtuosity as a so-called prison master and in the small doses of respect that this status commands. He counts himself lucky for the opportunity to go, as he puts it, tongue in cheek, on an all expense paid holiday to prison during monsoon season, when his tiny slum home will anyway be inundated and when food will be hard to come by. And yet at the same time, and on the other hand, Pawan expresses clear-eyed awareness of this dark irony and a keen awareness that life on the outside really ought to be better than life in prison, even if for him it often is not. Significantly, however, Pawan expresses these moral sentiments not in relation to his own surrogacy work, but instead in relation to his late career business venture, which involves training a younger generation of surrogates. And this becomes necessary once Pawan is too old to credibly pass as a 20-year-old. It's with increasing reluctance and disillusionment that Pawan sends, as Zen writes, younger and vulnerable boys, often arriving fresh from the village, into a life that they were poor and frantic enough to unwittingly embrace. And indeed, after one of his trainees is sexually assaulted in prison, Pawan marches straight to the prison guards to express his outrage. It is the surrogate, Pawan insists, who makes possible the multiple and necessary coexistence of incompatible truths, reconciling the imperatives of equal before the law proceduralism with the equally real existence of the political power and authority to sidestep that very same legal equality in the service of various hierarchies, hierarchies of caste or class or community. The surrogate metabolizes these contradictions with his own body. It is the prison master's stomach that digests the feces-contaminated milk, the surrogate's lighthearted humor and body dance numbers that calm the nerves of the guards and the prisoners. It's the surrogate's expertise in the arts of surviving prison life, expertise born at least in part of economic compulsion, that buffers public servants and prison guards from the ever-present dangers posed by the contradictory imperatives of political power and official procedures. For instance, if a court-ordered surprise prison check were to reveal that some convicted person is not actually present in jail serving out his sentence, it of course wouldn't be the political higher-ups, the ones who would have used their clout to arrange for the release of a wealthy or well-connected person. It wouldn't be them who would be held accountable. Rather, it would be the lower level prison officer who simply carried out the release orders who would be vulnerable to be targeted and sanctioned with allegations of corruption. So it's in this context that Pawan is outraged by the failure of these very same lower level guards to protect his young surrogate trainees from violence, since the guards are ultimately the ones who are protected by the prison surrogate's services. And yet the prison officer, in a particularly poignant exchange, offers no apology. And neither, more poignantly still, do the young surrogates abandon their perilous profession. Instead, they learn to navigate the dangers of prison life a little better. So that's the end of that. And just really quickly, I'll just race through some of the other examples. We have Gurupant Mishra, whose expertise is in producing crowds for election rallies. We have this one here. Wait, let me move this so I can see. Madhu Door Opener, he's an expert in publicizing the influence and affluence of local political leaders. We have Kaushal, land agglomerator, expert in transforming land into investable parcels and global assets. Imran, housing contractor, expert in carrying out home repairs in popular neighborhoods and informal so-called slums. Chadda, report maker. And finally, We have Prakash Data Entrepreneur, expert in surveying and mapping slums and thereby empowering other truths. I'll stop there.
Thank you very much, Lisa. Fascinating presentation and really would urge everyone in the audience to get a copy of the book. And now we'll turn it over to Nick.
Thanks, Mark, for the invitation. And thank you to the India China Institute for organizing today's event. As Mark mentioned, the book that I am talking about today, The End of the Village, Planning the Urbanization of Rural China, came out this past year with University of Minnesota Press. And it is based on an ethnographic project that I undertook in the municipality of Chongqing, primarily in 2011 and 2012, which is precisely when the Bo Xilai incident that Mark referred to occurred, and then through a series of follow-up visits over the ensuing years. And the starting point for the book is really a phenomenon that we are probably all very familiar with, which is China's rapid urbanization over the last 40 years, starting with the beginning of the reform era in 1978, and then accelerating further in the 1990s after Deng Xiaoping's Southern Tour and the beginning of fiscal reform in 1994. But this rapid urbanization has very much been premised on the exploitation of rural areas and the extraction of labor and land and resources and capital from rural areas and populations. And one of the sort of principal arguments of the book is that China's rapid urbanization in the reform era has been in large part produced by a disjuncture between, on the one hand, very stark and relatively rigid administrative and conceptual and categorical divisions between urban China and rural China, through, for instance, institutions like the household registration system, or hukou, that assigns sort of registration status to different people according to where they were born. So you're either, you have urban hukou or you have rural hukou, you have a hukou in a particular place, but also through institutions like land management, which separates urban and rural land into two separate management regimes, urban land being state-owned and relatively marketized, rural land being collective-owned and not very marketized. Also through governance institutions, planning, et cetera. So there is a set of de jure formal separations between urban and rural, which are inherited in large part from the pre-1978 socialist period. But as the reform era moves forward, increasingly the urban and the rural in China is encouraged to intermingle and connect informally for these various urban-rural intersections and connections to produce the extraction of these resources from rural areas to drive urbanization, whether that be in the form of, for instance, migration or land expropriation, et cetera. And so one of the arguments of the book is that it is this mismatch between, on the one hand, the rigid categories of urban-rural separation, and on the other hand, the informal interconnections between urban and rural that has really become a generative force in Chinese urbanization. Now, of course, as this process goes forward, it continues to generate rapid urbanization, but really, but also at the same time, is resulting in a growing rural development crisis, right? As all of this labor and resources are extracted out of rural areas, it leaves rural areas further and further behind. And that comes together in the late 1990s in an idea that is known as the three rural problems, or in Chinese, San Nong Wen Ti. And it really becomes sort of a key question of policy about what to do about the three rural problems, how to restore sort of stability and growth to rural areas. And it's this problem that confronts President Hu Jintao and Premier Wen Jiabao when they take office in the early 2000s, and they formulate sort of a policy platform to address this problem, which is called urban-rural coordination, or in Chinese, Changxiang Tongzhou, which is first announced in 2003 as part of the scientific development platform, and really represents a fundamental change in the way that the Chinese state thinks about urbanization, rural development, and urban-rural relations. So whereas in the past, urban and rural areas had been kept formally separate, and yet informal interconnections were allowed, starting with urban-rural coordination in 2003, the Chinese state begins to extend formal urban development processes to encompass rural areas, to create formal mechanisms of urban-rural connection. And so that really begins this turn in Chinese development policy that again begins in 2003, but really extends to the present day. So you may have heard talk about the National Plan for New Type Urbanization in 2014, which is essentially the equivalent of urban-rural coordination, but announced under a new leadership, right? Announced under President Xi Jinping and Premier Li Keqiang. And so the language of urban-rural coordination sort of fades away in the 2010s. And yet if you read urban-rural coordination and new type urbanization side by side, you realize that there is quite a bit of continuity. And that new type urbanization really sort of builds on and even amplifies many of the policies that are announced under urban-rural coordination. And that continues to the present day with policies such as rural revitalization. Now, if you look at the rhetoric of the state, urban-rural coordination is about using the principles of scientific planning and scientific rationality in order to resolve the contradictions and inequalities that are inevitable in the process of rapid development. And so the objective, according to the state, is to tear down these artificial formal barriers between urban and rural in order to allow both urban and rural areas, urban and rural people, to benefit from the process of rapid urbanization. And so one of the phrases that is commonly used to represent urban-rural coordination is that instead of rural areas supporting urban areas, instead now industry will promote agriculture and cities will carry the countryside. One of the things that we realize when you read into sort of more deeply into these policies is that this is not a straightforward rural development scheme. That in fact, at the same time that urban-rural coordination is intended to redirect resources to rural development, it is also intended to further encourage and further accelerate China's urbanization. And so we see that here, that urbanization has not slowed down, right? It's continued China has continued to urbanize very rapidly during the period of urban-rural coordination and new type urbanization. And in fact, urban-rural coordination and even more so new type urbanization are in part aimed at the near total urbanization of China's territory and population in a variety of ways. And so one of the primary mechanisms that is used to try to achieve this is something called hukou reform, which is a way to provide mechanisms for rural people to permanently resettle away from their villages and into towns and cities to transition from rural hukou to urban hukou so that they have sort of full membership in urban society. Another key mechanism is land reform, which encourages the concentration of villages, their demolition and relocation into high-rise new towns and urban peripheries in order to free up land for further urban development. And so both of these mechanisms sort of encourages the depopulation of villages and the resettlement of villages into sort of more urban settings or on the edges of urban peripheries. And this has resulted in a rapid decline in the number of villages during the period, particularly during the period of the initial implementation of urban-rural coordination. We see a decline of between 20 and 30% in terms of the number of villages. One of the arguments of the book, though, is that it's not just the real impact of urban-rural coordination is not only seen in these sort of more quantitative statistical measures or these more sort of conventional understandings of what rural urbanization might look like, where a village is torn down and rebuilt into a new town or an urban periphery, that even the villages that remain, that are not torn down, that are not resettled, are also being fundamentally transformed. And they're being transformed according to urban conceptions of the rural, right? Projected ideas of what rural development should look like that are rooted in an urban positionality by planners, policymakers who are, you know, have been educated in and live in and are fundamentally urbanites. And so I see this as a transformation of what I sometimes refer to as the working rural or the rural as a social form that supports and guarantees the survival and stability of rural residents through things like welfare redistribution into the countryside, or in Chinese, the xiangcun, things like rural tourist sites, industrialized farms, ecological protection zones, which might still count as rural villages. They might still show up in statistics as rural villages, but are now really working to support the needs of urbanites and urban consumption patterns rather than organized for the survival and welfare of rural residents, many of whom might not even continue to live in these places. So the book investigates this process through looking at the provincial level municipality of Chongqing, which as Mark mentioned earlier, is a provincial level municipality in China, one of only four alongside Beijing, Tianjin, and Shanghai. It is administratively one of the largest municipalities in the world. So its territory is the size of Ireland. It has more than 30 million residents, but that is really sort of an artificial, it again points to these artificial administrative divisions between urban and rural. When we zoom into Chongqing and the sort of the central city of Chongqing, the city is significantly smaller, but still a major city, right? In the 2000s is more than 5 million people. So I'm interested in Chongqing in this project, in part because it was designated in 2007 as one of the first of two national level pilot areas for experimentation in urban-rural coordination. So in 2007, Chengdu and Chongqing are designated as these experimental areas for experimenting with these various new policy approaches in urban-rural coordination. So I'm looking at a municipal scale, at a regional scale, but I'm also, the sort of the bulk of the book is zoomed into what I would call an experiment within an experiment. So much of the book is an ethnography of the village of Heilong, which you see outlined here, which is located on the western periphery of the central city of Chongqing, right on that urban-rural boundary, and in an area of dramatic peri-urban expansion. And Heilong has implemented a variety of its own experiments in urban-rural coordination, some of which complement the experiments of the municipal government, but some of which are in contradiction and in conflict with those experiments. And this is sort of zoomed in a figure ground study of Heilong. And as you can see, over the period of the implementation of urban-rural coordination, this village of Heilong has urbanized very rapidly. It's gone in the early 2000s as a real embodiment of the rural development crisis, a relatively backward, agrarian, very poor collection of small settlements, to, by the late 2000s, a very vibrant industrial estate focused on sort of furniture manufacturing, automotive parts. One of its factories produces parts for China's space flight program, to, in the early 2010s, transforming again away from industry and towards the tertiary sector. So building this new mammoth commercial real estate development, agricultural tourism, a conference center, high-tech industry, et cetera. And so the book is really exploring these different different groups of actors operating at different scales and their distinct understandings of what the rural development crisis is about, how urban and rural are related in China, and how they might harness urban-rural coordination to advance their own understanding of the sort of urban future of rural China. And so that includes Heilong's residents, both registered villagers with hukou in the village, as well as a population of about 15,000 migrant workers, largely from other parts of Sichuan and Chongqing, who have migrated to Heilong to take up work in these factories. It also then includes, at the scale of the administrative village, the village's leaders and cadres who are trying to rescale urban-rural coordination to the territory of the village in order to use urban-rural coordination to drive village development and capital accumulation. And then also at the scale of the municipality, the various municipal planners and policymakers who are tasked with implementing the municipal government's interpretation of urban-rural coordination and rationalizing the role of villages in the municipality's larger regional development. So, as I mentioned, one of the implications of urban-rural coordination is both the disappearance of villages, but also their transformation into what I call rural simulacra, these sort of alternative rural forms that reflect urban consumption patterns and urban conceptions of the rural. And what I want to conclude with is just a couple of pieces from the ethnographic evidence for why that transformation is really consequential for rural villagers, who rely very much on the socio-spatial fabric of the village for their survival, and in particular on these networks of mutual support and mutual care that have been built up over generations that operate along principles of reciprocity, or what in Chinese we might refer to as renqing or human feeling, which is allied with principles of guanxi or gift exchange, which you might be more familiar with. Those practices have been well documented in the literature. What we know a bit less about is how those practices are deeply embedded in village space. And so as these villages are being transformed and people are being separated from their villages, these networks of mutual support and mutual care are being disentangled and falling apart. And so, one of the ways that this happens is through shared housing, so extended families sharing space in a single domicile. And so, for instance, this is one village family that I worked quite a bit with that had three branches of the family, three siblings, all of whom have their own families. And so they pooled their resources and used their one plot of housing construction land to build a three-story house with an attached stairway, which means that each floor of the house can operate as a distinct living unit, right? They have their own kitchens, their own bedrooms, their own living rooms, et cetera. They can lock their doors. But then because they're all together, they're also able to collaborate and pool resources and take care of each other. And in particular, to pool resources for their ill mother, who lives in one of the ground floor bedrooms and is taken care of by one branch of the family. Similarly, this is another family in the village who they don't have as many resources as that first family. And so as their living circumstances have changed, they have adapted their housing to adapt to those new circumstances. So there are two sons in this family. When the first son gets married, he builds his own two-story addition for his family. The second son has a somewhat fewer resources, and so he builds an addition off to the right. And actually, what they do is they punch a hole through the wall to connect to his original bedroom. So now he and his wife have their own living space. And then as time goes on, they have children, they sort of take jobs in other parts of the community. And so the mother-in-law comes to live with the family to provide childcare. And so they just add another room onto the front, and as well as this covered awning space in the front of the house, in order to provide new living space and social space to allow for the expanded family. The other thing that's going on beyond these houses are these interstitial social spaces where people in the community encounter each other. They cook food outside, they play games, mahjong, cards. These are places where you're encountering your neighbors, learning about what's going on in the neighborhood, who is potentially having a bad month and needs a little extra help. These are where these networks of renqing and mutual exchange are happening in these interstitial courtyard spaces. And so as urban-rural coordination, as the implementation of urban-rural coordination continues, we see the demolition of the village and the replacement of this village fabric of individual homes with this high-rise new village, new town construction, which causes quite a bit of consternation and concern amongst villagers as they try to transition away from the networks of support and the lives that they've known in the past in the village to this new environment where they'll be living alongside urban families from the city who are buying apartments alongside them, strangers, people that they don't know, new ways of earning a living and surviving. That results, they move into these apartment buildings where they're, again, their concerns are realized, right? They're locked into these, little apartments where they don't have those spaces of mutual exchange. And you often find elderly people sort of sitting at the base of the stairway, which is the only place where they can find sort of traffic, where they can encounter other people. And so they feel quite alienated in these new spaces, sort of adrift in this more urban village space. That's about all the time I have. I will conclude there, but I look forward to your questions and comments. And I'm happy to talk about, Lisa's comments about comparison are really resonant, and I'm happy to talk further about that in the Q&A.
Thank you, Nick. Yes, I think it's pretty obvious to everyone about the comment about the rich insights from the ethnographic approach. So it's a comparison born by the methodological rather than the substantive or institutional or other kinds of questions that often highlight the differences. I'll turn it over to Amita now, and again invite the audience to please put in your questions in the Q&A, and we'll get to those as soon as Amita's comments are finished. Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks, Lisa. And thanks, Nick, for really, really fascinating presentations. Absolutely great. And I think I'll take off from this comparative bit, which is actually talking about the method much more than, and I think within the ethnographic method itself, I think both of these presentations highlight so many differences and also continuities in the approaches. So I think the speciality that characterizes Nick's approach, the human interaction angle, which characterizes, I think, Lisa's book in many ways. And where I thought also that in Nick's presentation of the book, one is seeing a move from the macro to the meso and then to the micro, whereas Lisa is looking through the micro to the meso, I would say, and the texture of that, what those meso changes actually mean. And I'm wondering what it would mean to perhaps have both these approaches to have in conversation with each other. Because I'm really, really tempted. I could see so many parallels between even what Nick was presenting at a macro level to think about what is happening in India and the Indian urban. And at the same time, also to put in conversation, because I really feel key sometimes having the ethnographic approach, is one aware also of the larger changes? Like as part of the India-China Institute fellowship, one was made so aware of the differences between the east coast of China and the other regions in China. Here again, one is talking about the east coast. Similarly, Mumbai as a city versus perhaps other cities in India, or Mumbai's location in Maharashtra as a state, which is also one of the most urbanized regions in the country, versus perhaps some of the other geographies within India, especially if we talk about the eastern part or the northern part of India as well. So I think this is something that perhaps one definitely needs to think about. The third thing which I felt was very interesting to perhaps bring in conversation with each other is also key, how does one situate the role of some of the people that one is meeting through both. So suppose I look at both of these narratives, then what is the role that one is looking at in terms of people themselves? And I think what one gets through Lisa's narratives is a larger story of contradictions, and within which people use their own agencies to navigate, and not just to navigate for self, but actually turning that into extremely generative opportunities for themselves and creating that space within a overall situation which doesn't give space at all. Is not able to create formal opportunities, livelihood opportunities for people. Within that, if one begins to locate this kind of a space. And in Nick's narrative, it's very interesting to see that one is thinking about what's happening to space, but one is not talking about what do people do? What happens to their living? What happens to their livelihoods? After all, life is not just about staying or living in a space, but it is also about working. It is also about earning. It is also about making meaning for self. And I think, how does one find meaning in those lives and that one is leading? And I think it will be great to have a conversation around these aspects also. I'm also trying to think about and taking inspiration actually from Nick's description of the very interesting way in which he portrayed the context. And Nick, I really like the way in which you put the overall rigidness of the way in which rurality is defined and ruralness is defined, and its tension with what the kind of forces of urbanization, and how does one put that across each other. A similar description can be also made perhaps about India itself. And there has been a significant amount recently written about it in terms of unacknowledged urbanization within India. And we have a similar rigidity perhaps in India as well. But of course, the controls of the state on space, the mutual controls that people have through collectives are completely absent in India. Rather, what exists is individual ownership of property in rural areas as well. And that begins to create a very different ethos around how peripheries get urbanized, the nature of migration to the urban as well. I think some of those comparisons may be fascinating as well. And if one looks at that kind of a context, then does that Indian context then create or make many more entrepreneurs who are also navigating between the different contradictions within urbanization? What would be the kind of interlocutors or intermediaries that one would find in China, and especially in this urbanizing China, given the kind of differential structures that exist there? I'll just stop with those questions, but really many, many thanks for those very fascinating presentations.
And thank you for those fascinating comments connecting the two. And I'll give a few minutes to each of the presenters to respond to, certainly not all, but just one or two of the points that Amita just made. Nick or Lisa, whoever wants to go first.
You can go ahead.
Okay. Thanks, Amita, for those really generative comments. Just quickly to pick up on a few of these things. So the difference that different regions make, I think, is a really interesting point. On that, just for brevity, I would do is plug a panel that I'm going to be doing in 2 weeks at AAS, bringing together several authors who have published recently on Chinese urbanization from the perspective of the interior, which has been historically understudied. Most of our work on urban studies in China has been focused on the coast, and I do think it makes a difference, right? We see sort of a different process unfolding, both in terms of sort of what the economy looks like, what the geography looks like, but also when it's happening, right? The fact that urbanization is happening slightly later in the interior is really important. On what do people do? Yes, absolutely. Sadly, just didn't have time to get to it in my 20 minutes. But yes, the question of how people make a living is central. I think one of the things that I would just briefly emphasize is how important it is to people in rural areas, people with rural hukou, to remain rural as a way of providing the flexibility to be both in the village doing village kinds of economic activities, but also have the flexibility to go into the city and migrate. And there are these, urban-rural networks where villagers weave together the best of both worlds. They're exploited in the system of rural-urban separation, and yet their survival strategies depend very much on their ability to go back and forth and, connect resources from both sides. This question of the similarities between India and China on the sort of tension between categories and processes. Yes, absolutely. So one of the things that I sort of explore in the conclusion of the book is how we might start to use what's been happening in China as a lens for understanding what's happening elsewhere in the world, and in particular in Asia, where I think the rapidity of urbanization in Asia, how quickly that process has happened over the last several decades, has really challenged some of these ingrained conceptual and administrative categories. And so I think there's a lot of generative comparison to be made. And in India, I would just point to Sai Balakrishnan's work on the transport corridors around Pune and the role of the panchayat in sort of negotiating some of these sort of processual sort of intersections. Lisa, I'll hand it over to you.
Sure. Yeah, thank you so much for these comments. I guess I'll just I'll say two sort of quick things, and they both relate to this again, this question of comparison. And I think it's really interesting and also challenging to think about how do we hold these two accounts in our minds together at the same time, and how what kinds of new questions do each of our books beg of the other, and what are the intersections? And so, for instance, Amita, you raised this question of, you know, what the Mumbai or Maharashtra in general is being, you know, the most urbanized region. And Mark, your book, Nick, your book is about urbanization, or a kind of, you know, shifting in, like, however you define urbanization. Obviously, that's a kind of, you know, discursive issue and a political question of what counts as urban or urbanized or urbanizing. But I think that, you know, one of the things that comes to mind when I'm looking, you know, just over the table of contents and thinking about sort of, you know, what we learned in Bombay from this exercise was that so much of obviously these domains of mediation, or, you know, these contradictions had to do with frictions or disjunctures that were effects of a kind of rapid form of, we could say, urbanization, but, you know, what urbanization means. So in a lot of ways, we could say that each one of these sort of thematic chapters, and I should say quickly that these thematic chapters did not precede the writing of the profiles. So the methodology by means of which we assembled this book was basically, I contacted everyone I knew with an active, it was like an ethnographic pulse taking. I mean, one thing which is true, not only is Bombay one of the most urbanized regions, it's also one of the most overrun by anthropologist regions of the planet. So, you know, I must have emailed like 70 people, you know, probably half of whom were, you know, are in Bombay, but and I just, you know, explained the project, and I said, look, you know, you've got the kind of main sort of protagonists of your story, right? Like if you work on Bhojpuri film, you've got like the director and the cameraman, and then like there's that other guy, right? And he shows up and you can't quite make out what it is they do for a living, but you know, without them, films don't get made or buildings don't get built. Or so, you know, what does that person do? So, you know, like this, we came up with this expertise, and then thinking through the material, we tried to figure out, okay, what are these forms of unnamed, morally ambivalent, often despised as well as, you know, celebrated, you know, by different people at sometimes labor, like what are they actually mediating? And what we found is that the contradictions were often born of different forms of urbanization. So whether that means institutionalization or rolling out of different kinds of policy frameworks, this is, so if we look at, you know, the cluster on so-called development, we've got somebody who, you know, is the housing contractor who works in informal areas, right? So you've got the contradictions of like, what does it mean for something to be declared a slum or to be, you know, unbuildable, but yet by other policy frameworks, buildable. So what we have in Bombay, for instance, is because of the rapidly changing policy frameworks governing urban land use, there's like 25 different ways in which tenure is, you know, legitimate, you can build, and sometimes they're in conflict. So anybody who wants to build or make investments in built space or in land is always vulnerable to being declared, you know, unauthorized. So you need somebody who can kind of manage things to mitigate those financial risks of having your, you know, you spend a fortune investing in your property and then it gets knocked down, or, you know, whatever it is. Like there's, so that kind of urbanization in policy frameworks, or, you know, we've got, you know, the land agglomerator, right? We've got shifts in financial, like the amount of money wanting to come into the real estate sector, like far outstrips projects, the ability of, you know, land title to be legible to global investors. So you've got people who will kind of do that work of, you know, putting, like, getting the papers in order so that, you know, money can land. And then we've got other kinds of contradictions of property regimes, which is another form of urbanization, sort of, you know, shifting in regulatory. And then we've got, you know, I mean, business is also like sort of urbanization or intensification of certain kinds of, or even if we think about urbanization as the shifting in the kinds of business activities, also entailing the removal of non-urban, so-called non-urban activities outside of the city. So getting rid of, you know, the tanneries or trying to get rid of the slaughterhouse, which, you know, is politically fraught. And how do these sorts of like navigating of like, how do we make more urban and less rural, like get rid of, you know, villages, like getting rid of the villages by turning them, declaring them slums and trying to stack them vertically and make them look urban. So some of these contradictions of like trying to become urban, whatever that means for whatever purpose, it's these kinds of things that these experts, and there was a question in the Q&A, I think Brian, you asked this question about what do we mean by expertise, and I can answer that later, but this is sort of what we find is happening. So the kind of comparative yield, I think would be, you know, maybe that to just to look at, you know, the way in which different shifts in like what are we talking about when we're talking about urban, and, you know, what are these changes, how are these changes maybe out of step with one another. So for instance, one of the things that I'll just end really quickly here, one of the things that, you know, I wrote about in my first book, and I also kind of talk about a bit in this one, in my profile of Dalpat, who his expertise is in getting water connections for buildings that where it's like impossible to get a water connection, but you need to get a water connection. So one of the things I learned in my earlier work on water was the way in which the kind of policy frameworks governing hydraulic engineering and also the planning horizons, the temporal horizons of planning were out of sync. So you've got, you know, urban planning, which works in a kind of like, you know, just-in-time market mechanism sort of temporality where, you know, you can knock down a building, you can, you know, knock down a slum and put up slum redevelopment housing as fast as concrete can cure, right? But to actually move water to that area of the city could take, you know, 3 years to rebalance a hydraulic system the size of Bombay, even if there's aggregate, you know, plenty of water supply in Bombay. So you've got you've got a kind of, you know, a disjuncture or a conflict in the sort of speeds or temporalities of urbanization. So, you know, that's, for instance, maybe one way of thinking about comparison. I'll leave it at that.
Well, it's been a wonderful 90 minutes. It's been very inspiring to see the fruits of the research in these two books. There's, you know, it goes without saying, it may be obvious, but the amount of work that's involved with ethnographic research, of course, is much, much greater and much more complicated than most other types of social science methods. Speaking of which, and this is another plug for a panel at the Association for Asian Studies, Tansen Sun and I have co-organized two roundtables called Methods and Concepts in China-India Studies. One will be on social sciences, one will be on humanities, and those will be recorded. Unfortunately, we can't all gather at the conference venue in a couple of weeks' time. But for those of you who go to AAS or view AAS, as the case may be this year, I hope you'll be able to drop in or at least view those two panels. Final thanks again to Nick, to Lisa, to Amita, to the ICI team, to Grace and Anna, and to Michael at New School IT for making sure we stayed on course and all together. And thanks to the audience for coming today, and we'll see you at a future event. Thank you.